Number 19. Number 19. Oh Lord my God, when I get lost and wander, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. My heart grew bound, a universe displayed. Then sings my
Beautiful home.
646 will be our song before prayer. After the singing of this song, Bobby Beasley will lead us in prayer. 646. Teach me more to obey by God.
Grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work.
Number 371. 371. This morning, as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper, we'll sing the first and third verse, please. 371.
When we meet in sweet communion,
prepare me.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody here today. Beautiful day outside, and we need to be thankful for it. Couple of reminders. Number one, remember our young people and some of the older ones too, who went CYC. They'll be returning home this evening, and also the elementary depot will be tonight at 5:15 here at Milton. So keep those things in mind. You know, when I mention the biblical character David, probably we all have our own thoughts, and some of us think, well, David was a pretty good guy, and maybe some of the rest of us think David was a pretty big scoundrel, and we just kind of have a mixed bag of emotions about David. But it's interesting how God thought about David. And maybe, just maybe, that's more important than your opinion or my opinion or anyone else's opinion. In Ezekiel 34, verse 23, the Bible says, "I will establish one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, my servant David, and he shall feed them and be their shepherd." Now, whatever else we think about David, he was a, shall we say, prototype of the coming of Jesus. Now, obviously, Ezekiel's not talking about David literally is going to rise up and be a shepherd of God's people in the future. But remember, Jesus Christ was a descendant of David. So what was there about David that's so important for us that we need to learn from him? Number one, David had the kind of heart that God always looks for. 1 Samuel 13 and verse 14, as Saul is being told, "You're no longer fit to be the king of Israel," Samuel tells him, "The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart." Tall order. That's some kind of really special person that would be a person after God's own heart. And when Samuel was sent to the household of Jesse to anoint king, obviously the first person he saw was Jesse's oldest son, big strapping guy. Surely this is going to be the king. And God tells Samuel in 1 Samuel 16 and verse 7, "For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." What God was looking at with David. He was looking at the heart. Think about all the psalms David wrote. Think about all the poems and the songs that he wrote in the course of his lifetime. And in some of those, he expresses his heart regarding God. For example, in Psalms 57 and verse 7, "My heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast." Do we feel that way? Are our hearts really fixed on God? Are we going nowhere because we are so determined to live the way God wants us to live? But then in Psalms chapter 111 and verse 1, he says, "I will praise the Lord with my whole heart." When we're here, we have an opportunity to do that. We have an opportunity to pour out our heart and song to God and praise him from the very depths of our soul within us. This is the character of a young man David. But then next, as we look at David's life, David always tried to live carefully and acceptably in God's sight. After the Goliath incident, David becomes a part of the army of Saul. And 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 14 tells us, "And David behaved himself wisely in all his ways." Now, no doubt in the back of his mind knows, I'm going to replace this guy. I'm going to be the next king. But David is careful. He doesn't exalt himself. He doesn't put Saul down. In fact, after Saul goes on the hunt for David, twice David will have the opportunity to kill Saul. He'll actually be encouraged to do so by his own men. And twice, David will refuse because he's not going to lift up his hand against the Lord's anointed. Well, David becomes king. God sends David on a military project, literally to finish what had not been completed during the period of the judges. In other words, the conquest of all of Israel's enemies around them. Well, in 2 Samuel 8, we read about the various people that David defeats, and then we read a note of quality about him. In verse 15, David administered judgment and justice to all his people. David was a good king. He did a really, really good job of leading the people of God. And that will earn him the right to be the prototype of the coming Messiah. David was such a good example that he will become the standard by which every other king of Judah will be met. And when Solomon rebels against God and lets his wives take his heart away from God, God promises him that the kingdom is going to be divided and it's going to be Solomon's fault. But in 1 Kings 11:12, he says, "Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father, David." God was going to leave at least a portion of the kingdom intact because of David. Because of who he was. Because of what he had done. In 1 Kings 15, in verse 11, we're told, "And Asa did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father." Now, just like Israel will be compared to Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who caused Israel to sin, Judah will be compared to David. And each king will see if he measures up to David. Two will receive especially good endorsements. One will be Hezekiah. The other will be Josiah. Two men who very much like David wanted to make sure the pure worship of God took place within the kingdom. But we'd be remiss if we didn't look at the life of David and realize that David had a massive moral meltdown. That's the only way I can express it. I mean, this thing is colossal. He will wind up paying for this mistake the rest of his life. And of course, we're familiar with what goes on in 2 Samuel chapter 11. How instead of being out in the field with the army, he's in Jerusalem. He takes another man's wife. And when he can't cover up that sin, He has that man murdered. Okay. David's king. Realize in that day and time, kings were absolute monarchs. When somebody went to a king and rebuked a king, they were literally taking their lives in their hands. And if the king didn't like what was said, they could be executed. But Nathan goes to him. Nathan points out the terrible, terrible nature of what David has done. And in 2 Samuel 12 and verse 13, we see that heart come again. Okay? The Bible tells us there, then David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. So when David sinned, David repented. His heart took him back to God. David had tried to cover the sin for a while, but he realized that wasn't going to work. It's not going to happen. That's not what God wants me to do. And so, I've got to come back to God. I've got to repent. There's a real lesson in that for all of us. We may have a heart after God, but we may have some kind of spiritual meltdown in our own lives. What are we going to do? Live the rest of our life with that spiritual meltdown and do nothing about it? Or are we going to allow our hearts to be pricked and do something? David wrote two very important passages during this time. In Psalms chapter 51 in verse 3, he says, "For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me." That sounds like somebody whose heart's come back. That sounds like somebody whose heart is broken. And quite honestly, we live in a world today where instead of people being brokenhearted because they've sinned, they want to rename it or reclassify it or try to justify it. They want to blame it on their family, or they want to blame it on their environment, or they want to blame it on society. They want to do everything but assume responsibility for the fact they sinned against God. He goes on in this chapter to talk about the importance of a broken heart. When we sin, we need to be miserable within ourselves until we do something about it, as David did. The other passage is Psalms 32 and verse 5. I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. David knew, you can't hide sin. David knew God searched the hearts. David understood all of that. And because of that, he wasn't going to try to, pardon the expression, put a smoke screen out there between him and God. Because he knew God could see through it. He knew God would understand. And the only way you and I can properly deal with these spiritual meltdowns in our lives is by repenting and asking God's forgiveness for those things. By being sorry. Paul tells the Corinthians, godly sorrow works repentance. And that's what you and I need. But what about Nathan? Did he recover from this? Yes. Now sometimes we think about the rest of David's life and we say, well, this cost David the right to build the temple. No. He did not. David was a man of war. He was a man of war because he obeyed God. God wanted those enemies destroyed. And when you go back and you study all of that, Before David ever went to battle with anyone, he always consulted the Lord. Is this what you want me to do? And so, yes, David in his own life did recover from this. And maybe, just maybe, that's the really important lesson for you and me from David. Yes, it's important that he was an ancestor of Christ. Yes, it was important that God chose him to be a prototype of Christ. But the fact that David came back tells us that you and I can come back as well. Hear God's commentary on David. 1 Kings 15 and verse 5. Because David did what was right in the eyes of the Lord all the days of his life, except in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. He had that moral breakdown. He let God down tremendously, and as I said, he suffered as a result of it. But do you hear what is being said about David? He served God all his life. What is he telling Solomon right before he dies? You be faithful to God. You trust God. You follow God. You do what God wants, and God will be with you and bless you. And what did David hand Solomon? He handed him the kingdom that God, quite honestly, had promised to Abraham. From the river of Egypt to the Euphrates River, that was the territory covenant. And that territory had peace. David ruled a kingdom that was marred by war. He had to do that to win their independence. Solomon inherited a kingdom that was dominated by peace. Because David did what God wanted. And David did it all his life. Now David had to bounce back from a lot of things. Saul chasing him when he was a youth. Treachery within his own family. Rebellions from outside. But in the end, David still right there with God. David still wanting others to serve God. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, one of the last things we know David did, the Bible tells us that he spoke to the Lord in the words of this psalm. It's not recorded in the book of Psalms. It's recorded in the history of David. Some people call him the sweet singer of Israel. And here's the sweet singer of Israel at the end of his life, still serving God. And David cries out to you and I, when we fail, repent. When we fail, get up. When we fail, get back in the race. So when we come to the end of our lives, we're serving God. Psalms 94, verse 22, and we're not sure when David wrote this, but it says, the Lord has been my defense and my God, the rock of my refuge. That's how he felt about God. Our God in heaven can be our defense. He can be the rock of our refuge. And so, what's the take from David? By the way, the song we sang, David, the servant of the Lord. What's our take? You and I can be servants of the Lord. You and I can be just as acceptable as David, as Moses, as Abraham, if we'll faithfully serve God. Do you know what God did? Christ. We've got to get in Christ. And we do that by believing on Jesus with all of our heart, by repenting of our sins, confessing faith in Christ, and washing away our sins in the waters of baptism. You know that, please, I encourage you to do something. And if you're here and you're in one of those periods where you've had a spiritual meltdown, a moral meltdown, don't cover it, don't hide it, don't deny it, repent of it. Come back. Serve God faithfully once again. If you need to respond to